Markup, our third bill for the current cycle, the 016 Legislative Branch Bill. Later today, we will continue debate on the floor on the Energy and Water Bill and finish our work on the Milcon VA Bill, so I hope we can finish this markup quickly so we can get back to the floor and do the chores over there. And I thank you in advance for the brevity of your remarks. Turning to the task at hand, let me now recognize the chairman of the Ledge Branch Subcommittee, making his maiden voyage across this rough sea, Mr. Tom Graves, Chairman Tom Graves.
Wow. Thank you. Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. You know, this process of crafting this bill reminds me a little bit of my triathlon training and experiences. It involves several legs, a few disciplines, and a little bit of endurance. When you start, you got a little bit of energy, you hit some walls through the way, and you got to push through those, and I think we might have hit a few walls along this way, but we have done well. We've got a great committee. They have pushed along. But when you realize you're getting close to the end of that first leg, you get just a little bit of your second wind, and you know it's in sight, and you're ready to move on to the next leg. And that's where we are today. We're finishing that first leg and preparing for the next. Joining this committee a little over 4 years ago, I said I wanted this committee to be known as a place where we were saving taxpayer dollars and not spending, that would be what we were known for. And in recent years, under the leadership of Chairman Rogers here, we have begun that process in a mightyful way, and that perception has been completed. This process has been very open. It's been very transparent. The committee has made a priority of ensuring that every taxpayer dollar is spent wisely, and in keeping with that trend, the bill we are here to discuss today holds the line on spending. It's a bill that honors and respects the taxpayers while preserving the beauty of our Capitol campus, providing essential security for visitors and staff, and ensuring that we're able to provide the services that our constituents expect and deserve. This bill provides a total of $3.3 billion for the legislative branch, excluding all the Senate items. The bill includes a freeze on all the funding for the House of Representatives, for our leadership, for the committees, and for the members' office budgets. It also continues the member pay freeze that was put in place in 2010. And in all, this represents a 14% reduction in funding for the House of Representatives since the Republicans gained control of Congress in 2011. More specifically, this bill increases funding for Capitol Police, and it allows small increases for several other agencies while trimming budgets in less critical areas. The bill recognizes the continued challenges faced by the architect of the Capitol. And now there's a balance that must be struck between preserving these historic buildings and funding other critical projects, including life safety projects. Overall, the architect's budget is one that was trimmed. The bill puts a new emphasis on transparency and accountability in the major construction projects under the architect. And that's why this bill transitions to direct appropriations from the Cannon Restoration Project rather than continue the use of the House Historic Building Revitalization Fund. This is a major change. This change will significantly improve the committee's ability to provide oversight for this major project. Additionally, this bill includes language that places a 25% cap on the amount available for larger projects within the legislative branch. In order to receive the remaining 75% of that appropriation, this new oversight requires a plan for any of these projects over $5 million to be submitted to the GAO and the committee for approval. And this plan must address any projected changes to the project schedule or the cost. And it must include a description of the safeguards taken to ensure that the project remains on time and on budget. Regarding the Library of Congress, this bill includes funding to meet the library's current needs, including an increase for the Copyright Office to reduce claims processing and analyze possible process improvements. Additionally, the committee will be working with the library in upcoming months to track its progress in addressing its critical IT infrastructure problems, which have been identified by the GAO in the recent report. And finally, a tight budget requires making some sacrifices. And so this bill includes $1 million to begin the orderly shutdown of the Open World Leadership Center. The fact is, the Open World Leadership Center was created as a one-time exchange program. But like many government programs, it has long outlasted its usefulness. While there is certainly a role for the U.S. government to play in this type of outreach, there are approximately 95 similar programs already administered government-wide. So in closing, I'd like to thank Ranking Member Wasserman Schultz, Chairman Rogers, Ms. Lowy, the members of our subcommittee and full committee, and staff for their hard work throughout this process, and particularly Jason Murphy in our office, who has worked tirelessly as we have gone through this journey. This is a product that I believe you can be proud of. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
We now recognize the ranking member of the subcommittee, Ms. Wasserman Schultz, for any opening remarks.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and congratulate Chairman Graves on presenting his first bill, his maiden voyage, and it has been a pleasure to work with you throughout the first phases of this process. You know, I joked in our subcommittee hearings that I'm getting a little long in the tooth for a legislative branch appropriations ranking member and former chair. It's not a subcommittee assignment that many members stay on for long, which is evident in that I have a new personality opposite me every time we seemingly present this bill. And that's by its nature because it's the smallest of all the appropriations bill. To put it in perspective for some of the newer members, as Chairman Cole smiles knowingly, we spend less on the entire legislative branch of this government than we do on many individual government programs in the other bills. In the defense budget, our entire Ledge Branch appropriations budget would be but a rounding error. The reason that I've chosen to stay and work on this bill is because a strong legislative branch allows us to better serve our constituents, and frankly, maintaining a strong legislative branch ensures that we're able to hold our own relative to the executive branch, as the founding fathers intended. It also has the ability to change the lives of the people that work for and with us. Now, I'm sure most of us read or watched the story last week highlighting the plight of a Senate cafeteria worker who lives on the street. The same contractor that provides services to the Senate also does for the House and the Capitol Visitor Center. Through this bill, we should and must ensure that there are no other Charles Gladdens who serve us during the day and sleep on the sidewalk at night. Unfortunately, this bill provides another year of flat funding, the third in a row. With certain agencies, the architect of the Capitol and the Government Publishing Office, sustaining cuts below fiscal year 2015 to support increases in other agencies. Now, I know if there was overall relief in the budget allocation that we'd see more investment in the staff and facilities in the legislative branch, but we're starting to cut into bone in some places, and that is unwise. The President has put forward a specific plan that will avoid sequestration's harmful budget cuts, and reduce the deficit in a balanced way. It is unfortunate that the Budget Committee did not do the hard work to at least meet the President halfway. As a result, although in past years we have done our best to fund critical life safety projects, and I think many members will recall through the last number of years that I have always said that that is something that we have to continue to focus on. If we cut other things that are maybe a little more nice to have, we have to make sure that we're funding the gotta-haves. And gotta-have projects like life safety projects are in that category. Many of those are not funded in this bill. And I'm not just talking about the ones that in past years we haven't funded. I'm talking about the above-the-line projects that are critical to life safety that the architect of the Capitol has said must be done that we are not funding in this bill. Cutting necessary upgrades to our elevators will not get us out of debt. And we should not be surprised if an accident happens because we didn't address important life safety projects. As we look to conference with the Senate later on in the year, I'm hopeful that both parties and the President can come together for another reasonable bargain that gives us more room for discretionary programs. There are not many new initiatives in the bill given the allocation, but I'm pleased the bill recognized the importance of the nation's copyright laws by providing some of the requested increase. The Copyright Office must improve the backlog of registrations as well as their business processes. Currently, customers can only submit documents on paper, which the Copyright Office then turns into a digital format, which is a glaring inefficiency. Our Copyright Office should not be conducting 21st century business in a 20th century format. The Copyright Office said it best in a report released in February of this year. There is a widespread perception that our licensing system is broken. Songwriters and recording artists are concerned that they cannot make a living under the existing structure, which raises serious and systemic concerns for the future. Music publishers and performance rights organizations are frustrated that so much of their licensing activity is subject to government control, so they're constrained in the marketplace. Record labels and digital services complain that the licensing process is burdensome and inefficient and making it difficult to innovate. So I'm glad to see the Appropriations Committee moving in the direction of fixing a broken system. The Copyright Office must provide the committee with a plan on how it will improve its technology needs. And Congress must decide how to best pay for these necessary upgrades. This is an opportunity ripe for bipartisan compromise. Mr. Chairman, I'm also concerned with the Government Publishing Office cut in the underlying bill. The office was formerly known as the Government Printing Office. With Chairman Cole, we were able to change the name to reflect what they actually do in this digital world. The Government Publishing Office publishes information online and plays a vital role in Congress's transparency. Unfortunately, GPO's request to continue to improve its online site, as it has been allowed to do each year, even under full sequestration, was denied in the bill. And that is the first time in recent memory that that has taken place. Mr. Chairman, this cut to GPO's online site continues to raise the concern from some that GPO could ultimately decide to charge the public for access to legislative documents as recommended to them by the National Academy of Public Administration in 2013. I agree with Chairwoman Miller and Bob Brady, the chair and ranking member of House Administration, who wrote to GPO stating, "Charging the public to access legislative data and documents would be a colossal setback to the progress Congress has made to improve transparency and access to legislative information." They said charging the public would be a direct assault on our ability to engage Americans in a process that is of great consequence to their livelihoods. While we share GPO's efforts to seek remedies to government-wide budget constraints that have impacted every corner of the federal government, in the interest of transparency and accessibility, we believe the publicly available documents should continue to be offered to the public with free access. Mr. Chairman, GPO indicated at the time that it had no plans to charge users for what should be public information. But what choice are we leaving them if we don't continue investing in their online systems? Also included in the bill is a requirement that the architects seek approval from the House Committee on Appropriations with GAO consultation for any project or phase of a project over $5 million. Mr. Chairman, I think that is evidenced by my record over the last number of years. I support strong oversight, as I have demonstrated many times over the last 8 years. But I do question whether or not the low threshold would unnecessarily hold up the progress of essential projects. We should require the assistance of GAO to review projects on the scale of the Cannon Building restoration. That makes sense. But nickel and diming this process and makes me question the GAO's resources, the use of the GAO's resources on projects as small as $5 million. To end on a more positive note, though, I'm pleased that we were able to provide $10 million to add to the House Historic Buildings Revitalization Trust Fund. We have been banking funds for our large projects over the last several years, which is imperative to help ensure that we avoid getting caught flat-footed if we experience unexpected costs in the future. And I appreciate the chairman accepting my suggestion that we show the amount of money that we are taking from the trust fund and have it reflect that amount in the Architect of the Capitol's budget, rather than leaving it in the trust fund budget and having it show there. So what we're doing this time is just showing an additional $10 million that we're banking towards future projects and reflecting in the Cannon restoration budget what we have taken out of the trust fund and showing that in the Architect of the Capitol's budget. And I appreciate the chairman's agreement to do that. As I conclude, I want to thank you for an open dialogue as you crafted this bill. While we don't agree with everything in the bill, I look forward to continuing to work with the chairman and all of the members of the subcommittee to make improvements. And I particularly want to thank the staff of the committee on both sides of the aisle who I've had the privilege of working with for the last number of years, Liz Dawson, Chuck Turner, and Jenny Pannone, Jason Murphy with Chairman Graves' personal office, Shalanda Young, Rosalind Kumar with my staff. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I want to begin by congratulating Chairman Graves on his first bill as chairman. I know he put a lot of thought, effort into this bill. The result is a fine bill. So thank you to you, Mr. Chairman, and to the ranking member and your subcommittee and staff for all that you've done to bring this bill to us today. As I noted earlier, this is our third bill. I wouldn't be more pleased with the clip at which we're getting our work done. This week has been a bit hectic because we had not only those two bills on the floor of the House, but this markup plus a markup yesterday in the subcommittee of another one of the bills, THUD. This committee exemplifies the good work that the Congress can do, even within tighter budget limits. The bill before us provides $3.3 billion for the Ledge Branch, including committee, leadership, and member offices, the support services we rely on to do our jobs, and the buildings and grounds that serve as our offices. This total excludes Senate only items which are traditionally determined by that body. This is essentially flat funding relative to current year and comes in $172.3 million below the President's request. This level continues the 14% reductions for the House since we took over the majority in January 2011. 14% reductions. And underscores our commitment to responsible budgeting starting in our own backyard. We can't ask others to sacrifice if we don't do so ourselves. Just as we're asking every federal agency to do, we as members of Congress must live within our means, tighten our belts, and get rid of the excess. We're lucky enough to get to come to work in this historic edifice, this Capitol Hill, a symbol of American democracy. The funding in this bill ensures that the Capitol preserves not only its sanctity, but its safety for all those who visit and work in these halls. It allows for necessary upgrades and repairs to the office buildings, continuous funding for the upkeep and maintenance of the Capitol grounds, visitor center, and botanic gardens. And the bill supports the functions of the Library of Congress, the Government Publishing Office, and the Government Accountability Office, services that enable us to do our jobs and do our jobs well. So I'm pleased to endorse this bill today, and I ask that the committee support it as well. Let me now turn to our ranking member of the full committee, my friend Ms. Loy, for any remarks she may have.
Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Chairman Graves, ranking. Thank you again. forget all we have these new
We heard
equipment.
You the first time.
Okay. I'll turn it off. Maybe you don't want to hear anymore.
Oh, no.
But I do want to thank Chairman Graves and Ranking Member Wasserman Schultz and Chairman Rogers for this bill. Today we consider the smallest of the appropriation bills which fund the operation of our nation's legislative branch. Without Senate items, the bill is $3.341 billion, and despite years of tightening our belts, the majority has yet again kept funding flat and further damaged this institution's reputation and ability to function at the highest level. The bill would slash Open World by more than 80%, while at first glance it might seem wise to reduce funding to a program that traditionally works with Russia, I would caution the subcommittee to not hastily cut this initiative. Open World fosters democratic principles, and we should be engaging, not dismissing, young Russian leaders who are not part of the central Russian government. Additionally, in a time of great need, we should not dismantle efforts to engage Ukraine and other Russian protagonists. Member representational allowances, or MRAs, would be frozen for a third consecutive year and are now $106 million below 2010 funding levels. Those reductions have severely strained the House's ability to serve the American people due to fewer staff for constituent casework, the inability to effectively communicate with our constituents, and fewer district offices. Finally, I'm distressed that the majority continued funding for a partisan lawsuit against the president. This is a waste of taxpayer dollars. It only distracts us from the serious work Congress has to do. And notwithstanding my misgivings, I want to congratulate the chairman for putting forth his first bill and working with the ranking member when possible. Thank you.
Is there further general discussion on the bill? If not, are there amendments, Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Chairman, I have a manager's amendment at the desk and ask unanimous consent that it be considered as read.
Amendment offered by Mr. Graves.
Without objection, the reading is dispensed with.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have a manager's amendment that has been agreed to by both sides here. Just a couple of minor changes since the bill was posted. One regarding removing language with committee room renovations, which is deemed not necessary at this time, and then another addressing some issues that Mr. Farr had that wanted to address the sledding issue on Capitol Hill, in addition to making sure that there's coordination and communication with the various first responders that Ms. McCollum wanted to address in some of the language, and we do not object to it. Yeah.
Ms. Wasserman Schultz?
We have no opposition to the manager's amendment.
Ms. McCollum?
Chairman, thank you to the chairman and to the ranking member. I expressed concern in the subcommittee markup, concern about lack of communication among our first responders when it comes to metro area stations. Many of our staff, constituents, and visitors rely on the metro to commute to the Capitol each day. In an emergency situation affecting the Capitol complex, it's critical that Capitol Police are working with the Washington Metropolitan Area Transit Authority and other first responders to keep everyone safe. Whether it's a situation like the one that occurred earlier at LaFont, or if there's an incident on the Capitol grounds requiring everyone to evacuate quickly, Capitol Police, Metro Authority, and DC Police, and all other responders must be working under the same plan. Unfortunately, during my conversation with Capitol Police, it was clear that there is no such plan or practice has been put in place. The language includes in the manager's amendment directs Capitol Police to report back to the committee on a coordination exercise with such plans being put in place in the future. I want to thank Chairman Graves for this. I want to thank him on doing this on behalf of our constituents, our visitors, and mostly our staff who need this service to come to work every day. Thank you.
Is there further discussion on the manager's amendment? Time having expired, the question is, support or rejection of this amendment. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. The ayes have it. The amendment's agreed to. Are there further amendments?
Mr. Chairman, I have an amendment at the desk.
Ms. Wasserman Schultz.
IT amendment number 2.
Clerk will read.
Amendment offered by Ms. Wasserman Schultz.
And I ask unanimous consent to
dispense
with the reading.
Without objection, the reading is dispensed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This amendment would simply establish a task force modeled after one established by this committee in 2012, the Bulk Data Task Force. In a time of increased IT challenges and threats, but limited resources, this task force would ensure that the House's efforts are not duplicative and take input from the many stakeholders that make IT decisions for the institution. Just like it made sense for us to do the same for the clerk as the keepers of the House's legislative documents to take the lead on coordinating efforts to improve the transparency of House legislative information, it makes sense for the CAO to do the same because they are the lead entity on IT for the House. So, this was simply establish a task force to allow them to do that.
Chairman Graves.
Adoption of the amendment.
I have no objection with the amendment. I think it's could be very valuable and a good report language to add.
Is there further discussion? Hearing none, the question is on the amendment. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. The ayes have it. The amendment is agreed to. Other amendments? Ms. Wasserman Schultz.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I have an amendment in the desk. Number 1.
Amendment offered by Ms. Wasserman Schultz.
Ask unanimous
consent. The appropriate place.
That objection.
That's what the reading of the amendment. Mr. Chairman, in my opening statement, I highlighted this bill's ability to change lives, although it might not seem like it could do so in a significant way. This amendment is our chance to do exactly that by standing up for the workers in the House cafeterias, people that we work with and who we see every single day. There was a story last week highlighting the plight of a Senate cafeteria worker, Charles Gladden, who was homeless. This amendment would help the cafeteria workers that we love and who support us every single day with sustenance so they can avoid the difficult burden that Mr. Gladden carries. His story has inspired us, but we all want to ensure that none of our workers are forced to live on the street because the most powerful legislative body in the world doesn't ensure that they can make a wage that can sustain them with the basic needs that all human beings need and deserve. Now, I hope the Senate is successful in their effort to change their contract workers' wages, but we must act as well. The House needs to act now to ensure that we set an example for how employers treat their workers, and this includes our contractors and what we expect of them. This amendment calls on the next food service contractor, selected by the Chief Administrative Officer, to provide a livable wage to its employees. The amendment sets no amount, doesn't establish a minimum wage, but it requires the contractor to use local economic indices to establish these wages. Mr. Gladden, the Senate cafeteria employee, reported that he made $11 an hour. He's a single man, and he's struggling due to medical issues and family requirements. Now, can you imagine how people with small children are making it on $11 an hour in Washington, D.C.? Mr. Gladden's situation is an embarrassment to this entire Congress, and it is one that should compel us, all of us, to act immediately. I'm asking us to send a message. To do business with the House, you must take care of your employees and pay them a wage that allows, at a minimum, for a roof over their head and food on their tables. It's not a lot to ask from the symbol of the success of democracy across the globe. And I ask each member for their support of my amendment and for your humanity in your consideration of it.
Chairman Graves.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Reluctantly I have to rise in opposition to the gentlelady's amendment, and I know her heart and her intent is good. We all want to see everyone enjoy the maximum wage possible, whatever their occupation may be. But it's really not within the scope of this committee nor subcommittee to micromanage all contracts that are engaged upon between the CAO and any contractor. Any contractor that were to engage in a contract with CAO or the architect or any other agency that we might have jurisdiction with, they're applying by current law, and they're abiding by the contract that was agreed to. And in many cases, it's different across the country. But if we start here, we start today, I can imagine that the fourth bill, you will see an amendment much like this that will begin going out across the country, and now we will be asking each and every agency to evaluate what is a living wage and put them in a position in which they become economic analysts instead of being able to provide the jobs and such that we are asking them to do. So I would ask that you oppose this amendment.
Is there further discussion, Mr. Farr?
Mr. Chairman, I didn't know this amendment was going to be introduced, but I want to speak in favor of it in this sense. We're in the House of Representatives. We represent a lot of cities. The cities that I represent have adopted this as a pro forma in all the different communities. And I think the wages are different depending on the economic status. But we call ourselves the city on the hill. We are the owner of this community and responsible for its budget, and that's what this is about. It seems to me that consistent with way Main Street in the United States is doing, we ought to follow that practice here, to have at least the contractors have to provide a livable wage. I mean, it's easily done, determined. It's probably more like $13 an hour instead of $11. But I think that we ought to provide that leadership. It's a responsible thing to do.
If there's no further discussion, Ms. Lilly.
Mr. Chairman, I think we should take this amendment seriously, and I rise in support of this amendment. The recent walkout by Restaurant Associates employees in the Senate highlights the unacceptable low pay and the lack of rights that the legislative branch contract employees currently endure. It seems to me that we as an institution should be a leading example of other employers around the country. And with Restaurant Associates contract up this year, I encourage the committee to protect contract employees as we do our staff in our own offices. We really do have an obligation to consider what has occurred and to ensure that none of the workers here are homeless. So I urge my colleagues to join me in support of this amendment.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like an opportunity to close when all members are finished.
Ms. McCollum.
Chairman, to the ranking member, so you would be looking, I just looked at the DC website, you would be looking, DC has a minimum wage, so part of your which is that they're describing as a livable wage. So what your amendment would do is say, in because of the way that you do the statistic and the analysis, that at the Capitol grounds in the heart of the District of Columbia, that we would at least at a minimum be at the DC minimum wage. Is that part of what you're getting at?
No, Not even that, Ms. McCollum. Let me read you what the amendment does. It's very brief. The committee expects the House of Representatives to be a model of employment standards, and this expectation applies to contractors hired to provide services to the House. To further that goal, the committee directs the Office of the Chief Administrative Officer, as it renegotiates the contract for food services, to issue a solicitation for and select a contractor who provides a livable wage to its employees, which the office shall define as the minimum income necessary for an employee to meet all basic needs. The contractor shall use local economic indices to establish these wages, shall include these wages in both its response to the solicitation and the contract, and shall submit a report on its wage and benefit structure to the committee on an annual basis during each year in which the contract is in effect. Essentially, we're just saying to future contractors who wish to do business with us, future food contractors specifically, this only applies to food contractors, take a look at what the cost of living is here and offer a bid that reflects in your wages what it would take for your employee to be able to sustain themselves and their families and essentially not live on the street. Not a lot to ask.
Gentlelady is recognized.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I rise to support the gentlelady's amendment. The biggest issue that we face today, the biggest economic challenge in the United States today, is that people are in jobs that do not pay them enough to be able to take care of their families, to be able to pay their bills, send their kids to school, can't even think about a decent retirement. That was the American dream, that you could have enough money to be able to do those things and live a good life. I think that, and what happened here last week with regard to not allowing us to say to those people who contract with the federal government that you take your money, you take it offshore so that you don't have to pay taxes in the United States of America. But yet we're going to reward you with a federal contract so that you can have a good economic life, not just a good economic life. You can be at the top of the mark. And what we have today says to those who contract with the federal government for food services, all we want you to do is to consider paying those people who work in this institution for us. They work for us. Allow them to have a minimum wage. Allow them to have, it is not even a minimum wage, a livable wage, a modicum of economic security that only matches the amount of work that they do. What is wrong with our taking the side of working men and women in the United States, but giving a break to those who would take the money and run? That is not equitable. That doesn't do anything to strengthen the economic growth and the security for this nation in the future. It lines the pockets of those tax cheats who want to take their money offshore so they don't have to pay taxes in the United States, and penalizes working men and women who work for us in this institution. Support the gentlelady's amendment.
Chairman Dent.
Mr. Chairman, I read that story, too, about that the Senate employee, the gentleman. It's a very sad story, but I want to say one thing, that we can stand here and talk about what contractors ought to be doing. If they're compliant with the laws, we're saying, well, it has to be a livable wage. Well, we should look at ourselves. Does everybody here pay their interns? A lot of us, we don't pay our interns anything. Should we demand that they all be paid at least the minimum wage? I guarantee you, I'll have fewer interns if we do that. I don't have the budget, but these interns look at the opportunity. All I'm saying is, let's not throw stones, and we in Congress don't pay our interns. We have contractors. I mean, the way to solve this maybe is to not contract out food service. Then we, the taxpayers, can run the whole operation, and we can pay whatever we want to call it, pay, and determine what that livable wage is. I mean, if a contractor's compliant with all the laws within the District of Columbia, I mean, I'm sympathetic, but I'm just not sure what the definition of livable wage is. If it's not minimum wage, what is it? I mean, there's a lot of ambiguity here that I think would need to be spelled out.
Mr. Honda.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I rise to support this amendment. I have interns, and the interns come in with certain kinds of backgrounds and expectations. I have fellows also, but I have paid employees that I expect to be able to compensate. I suspect that if we took this to the floor or to our own staffs and say, is there a better way we can pay you? Would you like more, a higher salary? I bet you they'd say, yeah. In terms of livable wage, there is a formula for that. And we, here in this, on this hill, we're the employers. We could say we contract it out, but that doesn't release us from our responsibility to make this a real issue. I grew up in a family that we were sharecroppers. And I suspect that that's not much different because our contractor was the folks that was getting all the money, and then they parcel out the money to the families. And remember Tennessee Ernie Ford? You remember Tennessee Ernie Ford? Remember that song he sang, 16 Tons? Well, these folks are just as, they're living in the same situation. How can we, in this country, the richest country, cannot figure out how we can provide a livable wage and have that as part of our contractors' requirements? We're the employers. And this is happening all across the country right now. They're talking about equity, equity in compensation. And if we can't look in the mirror every morning and say to ourselves, we're doing the best for our workers, we can't walk on the floor of the cafeteria and look at the workers who are serving us and say that we feel good about being with them. If we can't do that, then we ought to ask ourselves why. And just remember that we're supposed to be a land of great opportunities. We're the ones that are supposed to be providing the opportunity and figuring out ways how to do that. That's our responsibility. We could smile and laugh and everything else like that, but it's not funny. Not when you have to put food on the table at a minimum wage or even at $11 an hour. Let's try to live here at $11 an hour and support ourselves, let alone a family of four. Thank you.
Mr. Regio.
Mr. Chairman, I rise in respectful yet firm opposition to the amendment. I don't think there's one American that's going to be satisfied if a fellow American's on the street. So we share that concern. I would say, though, as I've listened to the debate and to a point that was clarified earlier, that the living wage definition is left to the vendor or vendors who would be submitting applications or bids.
Would the gentleman yield for a
yes,
clarification?
Certainly.
The living wage is left to the vendor to submit in their bid, and this is a food service contract that is only for the house cafeterias, and that standard is left to our chief administrative officer, which is, as you know, nominated by the speaker.
I would say even if there is absolute clarity on this, that I think it opens this up to a contested bid. You did clarify a question that I had, but I don't think it's proper that the committee engage itself at that level to prescribe exactly what the contractors have to pay to each of their employees. And so there's other ways to raise a standard of living other than this. And so I rise in opposition to it, and I appreciate what you're trying to accomplish. Thank you.
Gentlelady is recognized for a minute to close.
Thank you. Oh, I'm sorry. I think the gentlelady from Ohio.
Ms. Kaptur.
Yes, I'd like to rise in strong support of the gentlelady's amendment here. I am someone who is not that inclined to use contractors. If you really get below the surface, you find a lot of abuse. We certainly have found that in the Department of Defense and contracted workers and trying to get a hold of what really goes on. These are our employees. These are our responsibility as members of Congress. And each one of us faces these individuals as we move through these buildings. I served in Congress at a time when we didn't use contractors. And I feel it was a much better system. The group that currently has the contract isn't even a U.S. company. I wish the amendment had been to require that a U.S. contractor be hired if we're going to go the contracting route. Evidently, a company called Restaurant Associates, that's a British company, has this contract. America, imagine how the American people feel about that with what's going on in the job market today. So I want to commend the gentlewoman for offering this amendment. I rise in strong support. All the amendment says is that the chief administrative officer will renegotiate the contract and select a contractor who provides a livable wage and will use local economic indices to establish these wages. Washington is twice as expensive as where I come from. And so there has to be some kind of measure. If they're a British company, maybe they're a little insensitive to what wages really are required in a region like this. So though I don't support contracted out services in general, I support the gentlelady's amendment to try to fix what obviously has shortcomings in it. If we look at some of the stories that have been appearing in the papers and so forth, we should set a standard here. We should want the best for our people. Certainly those that are working in some of the lowest paid jobs in the country and serving the American people when they come here and visitors from all across the world, we ought to measure up. I support the gentlelady's amendment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And just to quickly, oh, I'm sorry. Forgive me.
Ms. Lee.
Thank you. Very quickly, let me first thank the gentlelady for offering this amendment. And first say that we have a responsibility for the people who work on Capitol Hill, whether they're keeping us safe, preparing our food, regardless of who they are. We need to set an example for the rest of the country and for model labor practices. Many people who work on the food service contracts do live below the poverty line in many respects. They need food stamps just to survive. Many are from communities that have been abandoned, where there are no economic opportunities. These people are working, and they're working hard. I've had many, many conversations with many of our food service workers who have explained to me, you know, why they think they're being treated unfairly. And so I want to thank you, Congresswoman Wasserman Schultz, for this amendment, because these are Americans. These are people who are working hard. These are people who deserve to be able to feed their family. These are people who do not need to be in the food stamps lines. These are people who should not be homeless. These are people who are trying to find pathways really out of poverty by working. This is an example of the working poor. And what this amendment does is just try to help lift these people into the middle class, out of the ranks of the poor, even though they're working. And so I hope you support this amendment. This is something that it's shameful that this is taking place here on Capitol Hill, where we're supposed to be the protector and the advocates for everyone who wants to live the American dream. Certainly, we can at least pay a decent wage so people can feed their families. Thank you again, and thank you for this amendment.
Mr. Jenkins.
Would the gentlewoman yield?
I'd be happy to yield.
Thank you. You know, I've listened to all the discussions and the philosophical perspectives, and I agree with much of what's said, but I'm kind of a technocrat, and I look at the actual wording. And I would like to go back, and an issue I'm concerned about is we all recognize that we know who will define what a livable wage is. It's the office.
Right.
They're to set that. So we don't know what that wage is today. That will be set at some point in the future. We do know what a minimum wage is by federal law and by state laws. So we know what that is. My concern is in the verbiage and the way that this is written is that it says, and I paraphrase, because it says that not only do you solicit, but you are selecting a contractor who provides a living wage as defined by the offices as the minimum income necessary. What you are doing by your amendment is directing and mandating that the contract be awarded. Because it says not only solicit, but it says and select. So you are tying the hands of the agency that's reviewing the solicitations, and you are mandating that they must select that contractor who meets the, quote, minimum income necessary. So if you had a bidder who came in and proposed and submitted a bid that was above the livable minimum livable wage, this would prohibit that governmental agency from selecting it, because the verbiage says to issue a solicitation for and select a contractor, and select a contractor. So you are required to select a contractor by your amendment. Minimum income necessary, and we don't know what that is. So if we had a contract,
I'd be happy to respond to the gentleman's comments.
Chairman, you.
He asked me to yield, but he has the time. Is the gentleman aware that in construction contracts that the federal government puts out to bid, this is already required?
Well, I'm very
federal
familiar with
construction contracts are already required. If I could answer the gentleman's question. So we already require this. I mean, you're expressing shock that we would actually suggest that a responsible bid from the House of Representatives in soliciting food contractors to do business with us do exactly the same thing that we already require in federal law from construction contractors. And so we're not suggesting that we do anything different than we're already doing and have been doing for many years. When you suggest that it is somehow unreasonable to ask for contractors to pay at a minimum a living wage and say that that's somehow amorphous and unclear, it's a minimum. And that's why we entrust our chief administrative officer to solicit those bids and then make the selection. We're not proscribing who they pick. We're saying that...
The time of the gentleman has expired. Is there further discussion? Gentlelady is recognized for a minute to close.
Thank you. Several quick points. We are not proscribing what contractors must pay. This is not a minimum wage amendment, and that was intentional. We would be including in our bid specifications what we're looking for in a responsible bid, and a contractor can decide or not to apply, as contractors do, based on whether or not they thought they could meet that responsible bid. Then our CAO, who we entrust with that responsibility, would make the selection. Davis-Bacon already requires us to make sure, for a reason, that contractors that we do business with are paying a living wage, because sometimes they don't. And Mr. Chairman, we are already micromanaging in this bill the architect of the Capitol's projects as small as $5 million. With due respect, one member's micromanaging is another member's essential requirement. We micromanage the heck out of things in every single one of these bills. And this is one that we should ensure that the people who work in the United States Capitol serving us and our constituents don't have to live on the street while doing that, providing that service. And I urge the members to support this entirely reasonable and human and humane amendment. Thank you.
The question is on the Wasserman-Schultz Amendment. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed will say no.
No.
The noes have it.
Mr. Chairman, with that, I ask for a recorded vote.
Request for recorded vote is made. A sufficient number in support. Clerk will call the roll.
Mr. Adderholt. Mr. Adderholt, no. Mr. Amaday. Mr. Amaday, no. Mr. Bishop.
Yes.
Mr. Bishop, aye. Mr. Calvert.
No.
Mr. Calvert, no. Mr. Carter.
No.
Mr. Carter, no. Mr. Cole.
No.
Mr. Cole, no. Mr. Crenshaw. Mr. Crenshaw, no. Mr. Cuellar. Mr. Cuellar, aye. Mr. Culberson?
No.
Mr. Culberson, no. Ms. DeLauro?
Aye.
Ms. DeLauro, aye. Mr. Dent?
No.
Mr. Dent, no. Mr. Diaz-Balart?
No.
Mr. Diaz-Balart, no. Mr. Farr?
Aye.
Mr. Farr, aye. Mr. Fattah? Mr. Fleischman?
No.
Mr. Fleischman, no. Mr. Fortenberry?
No.
Mr. Fortenberry, no. Mr. Frelinghuysen?
No.
Mr. Frelinghuysen, no. Ms. Granger?
No.
Ms. Granger, no. Mr. Graves?
No.
Mr. Graves, no. Dr. Harris?
No.
Dr. Harris, no. Ms. Herro-Butler? Ms. Herro-Butler, no. Mr. Honda?
Yes.
Mr. Honda, aye. Mr. Israel?
Aye.
Mr. Israel, aye. Mr. Jenkins?
No.
Mr. Jenkins, no. Mr. Jolly?
No.
Mr. Jolly, no. Mr. Joyce?
No.
Mr. Joyce, no. Ms. Kaptur?
Aye.
Ms. Kaptur, aye. Mr. Kilmer?
Aye.
Mr. Kilmer, aye. Ms. Lee?
Aye.
Ms. Lee, aye. Mrs. Lowy?
Aye.
Mrs. Lowy, aye. Ms. McCollum?
Aye.
Ms. McCollum, aye. Mr. Palazzo? Ms. Pingree?
Aye.
Ms. Pingree, aye. Mr. Price?
Aye.
Mr. Price, aye. Mr. Quigley?
Aye.
Mr. Quigley, aye. Mr. Ridgel?
No.
Mr. Ridgel, no. Mrs. Roby?
Aye.
Mrs. Roby, no. Mr. Rogers?
No.
Mr. Rogers, no. Mr. Rooney?
No.
Mr. Rooney, no. Ms. Robaugh-Allard?
Yes.
Ms. Robaugh-Allard, aye. Mr. Ruppersberger?
Aye.
Mr. Ruppersberger, aye. Mr. Ryan?
Aye.
Mr. Ryan, aye. Mr. Serrano?
Aye.
Mr. Serrano, aye. Mr. Simpson?
No.
Mr. Simpson, no. Mr. Stewart?
No.
Mr. Stewart, no. Mr. Valadao? Mr. Valadao, no. Mr. Visklosky?
Aye.
Mr. Visklosky, aye. Ms. Wasserman-Schultz?
Aye.
Ms. Wasserman-Schultz, aye. Mr. Womack? Mr. Womack, no. Mr. Yoder? Mr. Yoder, no. Mr. Young?
No.
Mr. Young, no.
Are there members who wish to be recorded? Mr. Fatah?
Mr. Fatah, aye.
Are there members who wish to change their vote? Hearing none, the clerk will tally. On this vote, the yeas are 21, the nays are 29. The amendment is not adopted. Mr. Fortenberry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have an amendment.
Clerk will read.
Amendment offered by Mr. Fortenberry, page 15, line 18.
Without objection, the reading is dispensed with.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. First, I want to also thank Chairman Graves for the gentlemanly manner in which we've been able to dialogue about a difference that we have in this particular bill. I offer this amendment along with Mr. Farr, and what it does is restore $4.7 million to the Open World Leadership Center Trust, removing the money from the Capital Power Plant, which apparently can't use that money in this year's appropriation cycle anyway. As a review, the Open World Leadership Center hosts emerging leaders, political and civic leaders from former Soviet bloc countries. Now, Congress founded Open World in 1999 in response to the ideas laid out by the Librarian of Congress, Dr. James Billington, on the future of Russia and how to build out, how to go about building out stable civil societies, the possibility for the rule of law, and the possibility for robust, flourishing democracy. Now, the budget for Open World has already shrunk considerably. In 2012, it was $10 million. Last year, it was $6 million. We have clearly had some entanglements and difficulties with Russia, and that programming component has been suspended. But the world has changed remarkably since then, and I'd like to make the case to you as to why this program has significant value. In the 15 years since Open World has existed, we've been able to forge relationships with about 23,000 emerging political and civic leaders in the former Soviet bloc countries. These include judges, legislators, entrepreneurs, journalists, and yes, many are from Russia, but it also includes the countries of Armenia, Azerbaijan, Georgia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Lithuania, Moldova, Serbia, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, and perhaps most importantly, Ukraine. Now, in 2013, the former majority leader, Eric Cantor, appointed me to the board of Open World. And I immediately set about the task of learning more about its impact, but also recommending some changes, one of which I think should be a name change to better reflect what Open World has actually been able to achieve. The second of which is to try to set up better measurables, analytics, to determine value of the programs. And the third is to try to move Open World's administration toward taking on the House Democracy Partnership's staffing. The House Democracy Partnership is an entity that many of you have been involved with. We have worked with countries throughout the world who have fledgling democracies, sharing our technical expertise as legislators with them in partnership, and it's been an extraordinarily successful program, both to give Open World as well as the House Democracy Partnership continuity in governance and more efficiency as well, saving both entities money. That's what I'm proposing. I think by doing so, we can repurpose Open World and fuse these two programs for better deliverables. But what are the deliverables that we have so far? And here are a few. There are 15 members of the Ukrainian parliament who are open world alums. There are 15 members of Moldova's parliament who are open world alums. 8 Russian governors, and 51% of the participants are women. I'd like to urge consideration of the amendment and look forward to the discussion.
Chairman Graves.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I do thank the gentleman for his thoughts, and I do reluctantly rise in opposition to the amendment, and he's aware of that. And let me say on the onset, I know Mr. Fortenberry is a tremendous proponent for democracy throughout the world, and he's advocated for that in each and every committee that we participated in and in front of this full committee. But we have to make tough choices, and this was a tough one. Our committee struggled with this. It may not seem like a lot of money to some subcommittees, but this is a lot of money. This was for us. And we had a lot of priorities to look at. As Mr. Fortenberry mentioned, he's on the board of Open World, and I would suspect he would make a great compelling argument, as he has. But to give you an opposing side to it, I'm on the board as well. And have found that this is the right time to begin winding something down in a very reasonable, responsible way of moving away from this program. And for several reasons. One, we have 95 other programs like this throughout the government, many of them in the State Department, which they rightfully reside. And I would advocate that we might want to continue that. But from an analytical perspective, Open World really hasn't been transparent with the subcommittee. There's not a lot of information that you can really gather. You go look for their annual reports. They're very outdated, and there's really been no tangible results that we can measure, and that's very, very important with the job that we have. And given this amount of money and some of our priorities, and I know he mentioned that this money that he's choosing to deduct from cannot be used this year. In fact, it's very needed for this year because it's a down payment. It's preparation for a future need that we will be required to fund at some point. And moving back to a very responsible, accountable process, we want to save in advance of some of those needs. But let me address two other final points, and then I'll close in my opposition here. Look, given the recent Russian aggression throughout Eastern Europe, this is not the right time to continue this program. And while it's had laudable results from 1999, I mean, this is from last century this program was instituted, it was a one-time program meant to last only for one time, and yet it's extended on these many years. But with this Russian aggression against our friends, while also supporting our enemies, this is not the right time to send more money to that area or that region. And keep in mind, we have economic sanctions against Russia. And this is, again, not a time to send more money there. And then let me address Ukraine real quick, because I think that's very important to us. A few weeks ago, Chairman Granger and I had the opportunity to visit Ukraine. We met with President Poroshenko. We talked about a lot of needs. And they're very grateful for our support, for our assistance. But not once did Open World come up as a priority. And I think that's very important to note. They have many, many other needs that are very important to them. And the best thing that I believe we can do to provide stability to Ukraine and throughout this entire region in Eastern Europe is through the 3rd Infantry Division from Fort Stewart in Georgia, which is already in that region protecting and defending and promoting democracy. And I'd ask that you oppose the amendment and stick with the bill as is. Thank you.
Ms. Wasserman Schultz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I rise in opposition to the amendment as well, and I think the members who've been on this committee for some years are very familiar with my position on this. This particular program, while in some ways is worthwhile, and I would agree with the chair that it is only in some ways that I think it has proven itself to be worthwhile, it is a square peg in a round hole in this bill. I mean, think about the things that we've talked about this morning that we've not been able to fund that are our essential responsibilities. I mean, this seems arcane and maybe inconsequential, but when we have plaster falling off the roofs of our buildings and potentially injuring people below, when we have employees, staff, and visitors getting stuck in elevators that really need renovation and overhaul. And the chairman, despite his best effort, has not been able to even provide the minimum funding for that. Can we afford an additional almost $5 million for Open World, which I have always characterized as a nice-to-have program that is better served in the state foreign operations appropriations bill? And I will point out, because I don't want to be redundant with what the chairman has already aptly argued, even the Open World program has applied for and received some funding from USAID. We applaud their initiative. If we believe that there's further reason to provide funding to this program, despite the fact that through the years that there have been nearly 90 programs doing something similar, this is not the bill that should have to provide that funding. So I would support the chairman's mark and oppose the amendment.
Is there further discussion?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. I rise in support of Mr. Fortenberry's bill. I've spent the last 4 years a lot in intelligence and national security, and it's a very dangerous world. The leader of Russia is a very dangerous person. And I have been testifying before this open world group as they've come into our area. It's just not about the military. It's about the relationships that are developed through this program. This is a program that not only, as we know, has Russia and Russian judges, but it's a program also that has the region, which allows the communication. And there's some things that we gain that I can't talk about right now, but there are a lot of issues in this dangerous world. I think what the rub is that the Legislative Branch Committee for somehow got this program. And I understand with Chairman Graves and Ranking Member Wasserman Schultz that we're dealing with basics and plaster on the wall and police budgets and that type of thing. But I would think at this point that we need to reevaluate, maybe with Chairman Granger, and look at this as a program that is worthwhile to that region and a very dangerous region right now. I think it's to the benefit of the world, that region there, and the United States of America and their security. So I would hope that this is something that we can move forward and move on with Mr. Fortenberry and then reevaluate it with Chairman Granger and her subcommittee to move forward with this program. You know, what we do here is priorities. That's why we have to do something, you know, about the sequestration. But it's about priorities. And in my opinion, based on a lot of these other programs that are out there, this is a priority to our national security and developing relationships with judges, with leaders for the future.
Further discussion? Ms. Kaptur?
Yes. I rise in strong support of the Fortenberry Amendment. The Library of Congress belongs to us. It is the largest library in the world. Its ability to communicate cross borders is unrivaled. And with the onset of the age of the Internet, its capacity to build liberty is unsurpassed. The Open World Program, whatever it might be called, and I like the name Open World, has an ability to reach those that, frankly, AID could never find, and certainly the AID contractors. I've had plenty of experience with them. Bureaucratic, large consulting companies parked in fancy apartments in foreign countries. The Open World Program is different. I didn't know this amendment was coming up. I began my week in Ohio this week in a little elementary school where children had collected 800 books, children's books written in English. And they'd been collecting them for months because they had met on an open world exchange, a mayor and a teacher and farm women from little villages inside of Ukraine. And they've collected these books and they were packing them to send to that village so that the children could learn English. Learning. That village is not connected by internet. AID has never found that village. But Open World did. I don't know if anybody's noticed, but Russia has killed over 5,000 people in Ukraine. Ukraine is defenseless. I could give a whole speech about that. Why would we as Congress at this moment do anything that would harm connections that are fragile and very important to the advance of liberty in a part of the world that has suffered more than any part of this globe because of tyranny? I think it belongs in the Library of Congress. I think their broadcasting capabilities, looking toward the future, and places where we can reach to help people learn, are priceless. I urge my colleagues to seriously consider voting for the Fortenberry Amendment. I don't think we have a minute to lose in terms of what's going on in that part of the world. Thank you very much.
Mr. Price.
Mr. Chairman, I too rise in support of the Fortenberry Amendment. This legislative branch program that serves this body and our nation well. The bill in front of us today provides $1 million to shut down the program. Program in the former Soviet and Soviet bloc countries. At a time when these countries are under pressures as never before. Let's just stipulate, this isn't President Putin's favorite program. To put it mildly, but he hasn't been able to stop it. And it's more important than ever, not just in Russia, but in democracies and would-be democracies like Ukraine and Moldova and Kyrgyzstan and Georgia. We should be proud of this program. We should defend it as an outreach from this institution. It's the best program like this I've ever seen. I don't know about these 90 other programs. I don't know what those are supposed to be, but this is a unique program, unique in its concept and unique in its scope. The participants are not the people who typically participate in international exchange programs. Mr. Fortenberry's language reinforces that. They're not just the elite who live in the capital city and venture to other nations frequently. No, these are teachers, judges, local officials, young activists, people who live in rural areas often and small towns. It penetrates deeply. It's really unique in that respect. It penetrates deeply. It's not a run-of-the-mill program. I know this because I've personally participated, and many of you have. This is a well-designed program designed to make a difference. It goes beneath the surface. I invite you to talk to any of our diplomats in these participant countries. You'll figure out very quickly how unique this program is, how valuable it is. I was at a conference just a month ago run by the Aspen Institute, focusing on the resurgent Russia and Eastern Europe. This was a group of diplomats, former diplomats, academics, members of both House and Senate from both parties. There was a set of policy recommendations that came from this conference, and it specifically said Congress should reinforce the Open World Program as a vehicle for promoting greater people-to-people exchanges between America and Russia, especially among civic leaders. Now, there have been questions raised persistently about the presence of this in the legislative branch, other than the executive branch. I think, in fact, the placement of this in the legislative branch is an asset. It's made the program unique, able to create successful and long-term relationships between Americans and former Soviet bloc citizens. The fact that it's not tied to a specific administration with its goals and policies. There's no hurdle to participation. Additionally, because of its placement, the program cannot get lost in the State Department bureaucracy. Finally, Mr. Chairman, true, this is not about ourselves. No, this is not about ourselves. This is about other people. This is about other nations. This is about a unique outreach that we, as the legislative branch, can endeavor. Please look at this. Look at this objectively and support this amendment.
Gentlelady is recognized. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, I've been to Ukraine twice in the last 2 months and received two large delegations for Ukraine. It's very important to us. What we're doing is very important to us. However, I support the chairman's decision on this program. Everybody in this room is appropriations, has programs that they like, that they support. We're at a time where we're having to make very tough decisions on what we can afford in our bills, and so I support the elimination. Thank you.
Mr. Amadei.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Briefly, I understand that emotions are appropriate and then they run high, but I think a couple things are worth bearing out that kind of go with the ranking member's testimony, and that is we're not turning the lights out on outreach to Eastern Europe. And you've heard uncontroverted indications that there are over 95 programs that do things like this. So this is not about do we continue to talk to Eastern Europe or not. And the other thing that I got to tell you is personally troubling is there's been an allegation that nobody's refuted that this organization has not been real transparent in terms of other sources of funding that they have been successful in obtaining to fund, I believe, a significant portion of their operations. So with all due respect, and unless something has been misrepresented, this is not about going forward or not with outreach to Eastern Europe and former Soviet Republic. It's whether or not, in the context of this small appropriations bill, with other decisions that we're all unhappy about, that you ought to spend between $4 and $5 million on this. I yield back. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Farr.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I plead with you. I mean, this is our program. This is legislators to legislators program. You want to own this. You didn't delegate when you were in the state legislature that somebody else joined NCSL, or that you, as a member of this Congress, that you've given up Atlantic parliamentary networks. We need to talk to legislators. You cannot delegate this to USAID. Look, if there are 95 other programs, you don't know a damn thing about any of them. The only reason we're talking about this one is because it's in our budget. It's the only program that's in this budget. If we were really looking at all the memberships and all of the programs, what you'd come back to is, hey, we can't just invest in foreign aid, giving money to governments, and then hoping that the legislative branch, who's going to administer all this money and control the laws in that country, don't have any training or don't have any upgrading. Right after we leave here at this noon, I've got to go speak to 20 parliamentary people from Nepal, Ukraine, Afghanistan, and Kosovo. They've come here to learn how the legislative process works, how to have a Library of Congress, how to have an independent budget analysis. These are things you cannot delegate. It's professional to professional. Parliamentarians don't want to just go talk to staff of USAID. They're elected like us. They want to talk to us. This is the only program in this budget. Don't destroy it right now. Let's get at, if we're going to do this, let's take in all the other 95 programs. And let's see whether they are cost effective and whether we can get a better bang for the buck. If you give this one up, you're saying that all of our investments overseas it doesn't matter what the government of those countries do. I am excited about this program because I had this program in my district. Roger Wicker got me involved in it. And it was a lot. I took the Russian folks to planning committees, to boards of supervisors and city councils and school boards, and there was one member from the Duma. And he says, you know, I've been invited by your country 15 times to come to the United States. And I've never been able to see the country as at the local level. He said, this is the first time I really understood what your democracy is all about. Let's not abandon this program. Let's fix it.
Is there further discussion? Hearing none, Mr. Fortenberry is recognized for a minute to close.
Well, thank you all for the robust discussion here. This is not just another exchange program. It was founded by Congress, purposefully put in the legislative branch, so that we could respond to the unique needs that are evolving in this very volatile part of the world. Reforms are needed, but I think we can achieve those with some effort and some initiative to make this program smarter, more accountable, as well as more effective with some of the things I've proposed. Now, many of us anyway, voted to send arms to Ukraine. Well, I think we need a weapons delivery system for democracy. And I believe in a 3D policy for international stability. That's our strong defense, smart diplomacy, and smart development. And if we can hold on to this program, make it more robust, we can build out thoughtful leaders who are committed to civil society, the rule of law, the right type of reform, then we have a chance for international stability in that part of the world, and our own national security is intimately tied to this. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All time has expired. All those in favor of the Fortenberry Amendment will say aye.
Aye.
Opposed will say no.
No.
The ayes seem to have it. The ayes have it. The amendment is agreed to. Mr. Bishop.
Mr. Chairman, I don't know what the appropriate parliamentary procedure is, but I move to strike the last word so that I can make a comment about one of the items in the budget. And I want to just say a few words, Mr. Chairman, in support of the Government Publishing Office. Under the bill that the subcommittee has brought forth, the Government Publishing Office is funded at $110.2 million, which is $9.8 million below the FY15 budget. I wanted to just say I had the opportunity to serve on this subcommittee for, I think, three terms, and to look very closely at all of the agencies that are under this subcommittee's jurisdiction. And of all of the agencies, the Government Publishing Office, which recently had a name change from the Government Printing Office, I think has really, really been a good steward of the resources that have been provided to it. And they've been efficient, they've been frugal, and particularly in the times of budget challenges that we've had over the last 5 years, they've been exemplary. And given tangible results, as the chair has indicated he'd like to see. But a year ago, Congress and the President agreed to rename the GPO, the Government Publishing Office, based on the broad range of digital services that the agency provides. The Subcommittee on Legislative Branch supported this change. This year, the Subcommittee voted to cut those operations by eliminating the appropriated funding for the GPO's federal digital system, which provides free digital access to more than 1 million congressional and other government document titles that over the past 5 years have been downloaded by the public more than a billion times. This cut just doesn't make sense for an office that has transformed us from a paper environment. And they were printing millions and millions of pages every day to supply this Congress, and now it's all done digitally, which has saved us a tremendous amount of money. This will severely curtail the GPO's ability to add new digital documents to its federal digital system. It'll zero out the funding for initiatives that support the missions for congressional and legislative branch organizations, such as the Clerk of the House of Representatives, the Secretary of the Senate, and the Library of Congress, who rely on information from the federal digital system in order to feed the websites such as congress.gov and docs.house.gov. Over the past 2 years, the GPO has been a major player in the work of the House Bulk Data Task Force, which was established by the leadership to bring more transparency and openness to House legislative operations. GPO has made House bills and House bill summaries prepared by the Congressional Research Services, available for bulk data download through its digital system. The funding cut will reduce the number of skilled technical staff members who work on the federal digital system, impairing the GPO's ability to respond to this. It just doesn't make sense. I believe that we should look at this very carefully, and I'm not offering an amendment, but I hope that before the process is over, that we can talk about it and really review the effectiveness and the need and the utility for this. And with that, I
yield. Are there further amendments? Mr. Quigley.
I have an amendment at the desk.
Clerk will read.
Amendment offered by Mr. Quigley, page 23, insert after line 19.
Without objection, the reading is dispensed with.
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to offer this and withdraw it, but I believe it's time to begin talking about this seriously. I'm also the co-sponsor of an amendment of a bill to provide that congressionally mandated reports be made public. It's something like a scene in Raiders of the Lost Ark, the reports that we write, right? On the CRS side, it's already $100 million. So we spend all this money, the CRS reports and the congressionally mandated reports, and then they gather dust in the staff's office, right? The public pays for these, a lot of good information. We all approve these, we vote for these, and they're often extraordinarily well done, but then they disappear, and that has to end. Speaking just on the CRS aspect of this, opening CRS to the public would empower our constituents with extraordinary information about key issues, policy, and budgets we're debating here in Congress. increasing government transparency and giving the public the tools they need to hold us accountable. It's simply good policy to allow educators, students, the news media, and everyday citizens access to these CRS reports. Now, despite what some extraordinary people have said and misrepresented about this amendment, we're not talking about the confidential reports that individual members ask for from CRS. They prepare hundreds of reports annually on general topics. That's what we're talking about with this amendment. I understand there's some hesitation from this committee on making these reports publicly available. That's why I was offering an amendment that provides a middle ground approach to help address these concerns. My amendment simply requires CRS to keep an updated list of their published reports on a publicly available website. Like I said, members of Congress can already make CRS reports available to their constituents, but without knowing what's available to them, this option is extremely limited and hardly transparent. My amendment would simply increase transparency of what reports are available for the public to request. At a time when the American public are asking for increased government transparency, at a time when there is a serious void of accurate, objective, and nonpartisan information in public discourse, and oh, by the way, they don't trust us. I don't know that they ever did, but they don't trust us now. Public approval of Congress is around, what, 9%? When asked if they trust us as a government, we're at a whopping, what, 16 to 18%. I recognize, coming from Illinois, where three of our last five governors are either in jail or went to jail, two of the last four predecessors from the 5th Congressional District are in jail or went to jail. One of them is a bonus, serving both as a congressman and a government. Folks, I hear the jokes all the time. I was on Colbert, and Colbert said, "So Quigley, Rostenkowski, Blagojevich, have you picked out your jail yet?" I hear all the jokes on the House floor, and it's really bad when they come from states that actually have more indictments than we do. The two aren't necessarily related, folks, but they have to do with the fact that the great cost of corruption, hey, and I'm from Chicago, the greatest cost of corruption is not the dollars lost, it's the loss of the public's trust. As Justice Brandeis said, sunshine is the best of disinfectants. I think we need to accept that, and that the public acknowledges that it's all in the same realm. They want to know how we're making our decisions. A lot of the reasons we make our decisions are the reports that we write, CRS and congressionally mandated. This is one matter. I simply ask that we consider this, and perhaps those who are interested in working on this, let us know. We'll meet with CRS how to overcome the obstacles in its way. Thank you.
Chairman Graves.
Well, I thank the gentleman for his comments, and I thought I heard in his comments that he intended to withdraw his amendment. Let me say, I look forward to continuing the conversation, but I would advise the gentleman to not pin all his hopes on Illinois politics on CRS reports being publicly disseminated. But thank you for the conversation.
Amendment is withdrawn. Mr. Honda.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have an amendment at the
clerk
desk. Respectfully waive the reading.
Which one?
Amendment 2. Thank you.
Amendment offered by Mr. Honda.
Without objection, the reading is dispensed with.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member Wasserman, for holding this hearing today. This committee can have an important impact on the issue of employment discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation and gender identity. My amendment simply would require the Office of Compliance shall track, report, and annually publish all aggregate statistics of their report every day from covered classes, including sex, race, and disabilities. The report would include general information requests, requests for confidential counseling, requests for mediation, adjudication of claims, appeals, and all of the relevant actions or proceedings for allegations of workplace discrimination on the basis of actual or perceived sexual orientation and gender identity. The Office of Compliance supports my amendment. And for the many LGBT employees of the House today and tomorrow, we must ensure that employment discrimination has no place in this Congress or any thereafter. After all, securing the comfort and protection of our employees ultimately serves our nation. I know each one of us share in the honor and privilege of serving our constituents and our nation. As we fight for civil rights and human rights of all people across America, let us begin in the House, the people's House. I yield back. Thank you.
Chairman Graves?
Sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and appreciate the gentleman's comments and his willingness to withdraw the amendment. Thank you.
Ms. Wasserman Schultz?
Thank you. I was also just making sure that the gentleman intended to withdraw the amendment.
Yes, and I'd like to continue to work with our leadership in order to be able to have this included eventually, because I think that this is something that sits out there and it's an issue that we have to address. Our country's been addressing this all across all the states, and it's time that we ourselves on the Hill address this issue forthrightly and be able to put this into wordings. Thank you very much.
Amendment is withdrawn. Are there any further amendments? Hearing none.
Mr. Chair, I have one other that I intend to withdraw, and that's the...
The gentleman will suspend. Clerk will read.
Amendment offered by Mr. Honda. Insert the following text after the end of the last paragraph under the section titled Legislative Branch Wide Matters.
Yes, this is Amendment 1. Just very briefly, I just wanted to discuss a committee on House Administration that would establish a Chief Technology Officer Task Force to determine the feasibility of a bicameral office, the Office of Chief Technology Officers. It has many responsibilities that I think we should look at on the Hill to be able to become more efficient. I would like to continue to work with the leadership, and at this time I'll withdraw this amendment.
Amendment is withdrawn.
Can I, Mr. Chairman, with your indulgence?
The lady's recognized.
Thank you. I appreciate the gentleman withdrawing the amendment. If we are going to move forward, and I will discuss this with Chairman Graves, on anything reflecting language like this, that we absolutely make sure that there is no identifying information, not only on individuals, because these are confidential counseling requests, but also no information on the agencies where they occurred, or anything other than aggregate information. And I would want to further understand why the gentleman thinks this is necessary in the first place before moving forward. So just wanted to make sure that I put that out there.
Are there further amendments? Hearing none. Before we have a motion to approve the bill, I think we ought to recognize the members of this subcommittee, both sides of the aisle, who did the work on this bill. Would you people stand, the members of the subcommittee? Stand, yeah. Limber up.
Oh, my goodness, this is new.
Thank you. I think what the committee's saying is, we love you. Now, if there's no further amendments, I recognize Mr. Feelinghausen for a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move to favorably report the Legislative Branch Appropriations Bill for the fiscal year 2016 to the House.
You've heard the motion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. The motion is agreed to. I ask unanimous consent that the staff be given the authority to make technical and conforming changes to the items approved today. Without objection, so ordered. And the gentlelady is recognized for 3 days. If there's no further business, the committee stands adjourned.
Good job.
Thank you. Good job.
Thank you.
Maiden voyage.
Maiden voyage.